Archaeologically, the significance of these three great Chola temples, Brihadisvara, Gangekonda Cholapuram, and Airavateshvara, can you explain?
Brihadisvara, which was originally called Rajarajeshvara, built by the Chola Emperor, the first Rajaraja Chola. He is the most outstanding temple that has been meticulously planned on a very grand scale, and every aspect of the temple, architecture, sculpture, images, bronzes, inscriptions, etc., has been pre-planned where each one should take its place and how it has to be articulated with the central image, the huge linga serving as the central point. And it is thus the peak of Chola architecture. It reached the height, you can almost call it the Himalayas of the Chola architecture. Also, beyond Himalayas, we have some poetic imagery of a mountain peak called Meru, which was said to be golden. And this concept of Mount Meru, with the concentric circles of peak going around, each one representing a personification of a deity, taking its abode there. This has influenced the architectural formula of this main vimana around which the enclosure has been built and the entrance towers have been built. So this forms the almost the beginning of monumental architecture, and we may say almost the culmination of the architecture, Chola architecture. Now, almost 20 years later came this Gangai Konda Cholapuram temple, which was built by Rajendra Chola, the son and successor of Rajaraja. It adopted a different format, different plan, different elevation, and also drawing from the experience of what it has done at Tanjore, its articulation is slightly different, but essentially you see a unitary approach in both the Gangai Konda Cholapuram and its predecessor, Brihadisvara or Rajarajeshvara temple at Tanjore. The Rajarajeshvaram, built by second Rajaraja Chola, which came to be called as Dharasuram in later period, was built around say 1150 or so, and we have altogether a different format, a different plan, different elevation, and also enclosures and expression of these sculptures on its body give a different philosophy. And so that shows that there have been more ideas coming from different parts of the country, especially from Bengal region. And it has brought philosophy, architecture, form of worship, etc., which is attested by inscriptions on the temple itself. And so we see a slightly different variation, slightly different emphasis. So all these three, each represent a stage in the evolution and also in representation. But nothing to beat the Brihadisvara temple at Tanjore in what we call the planning vastu pada vinyasa, the layout of the ground plan originally, and then vastu purusha mandala, the circles of distributing main deity and secondary deities all around its wall of the main vimana, and also in the secondary shrine of the enclosures. And it's not only the stone sculptures which are consecrated in the enclosures, secondary shrine, even the position of the bronze images, a large number of bronzes were donated by both Rajaraja, his sister, and also his queens and others. And even the position and direction of these bronzes in the surrounding enclosure, sub-shrine, have been pre-planned. And they bear the inscriptions referring to them exactly in the same position where it ought to have been. Unfortunately, those old bronzes are no more, except one Nataraja. But we could see the inscription referring to the Nataraja shrine is exactly behind the modern Nataraj Mandapa in the enclosure in the northeastern direction. So, the first and foremost about the Brihadisvara temple is the layout and its orientation, and also the distribution of various shrines. And so far as the main Vimana is concerned, we have different groups of deities represented on the walls. One are the major classical images like Siva as Chakradana Murti, or Nataraja, or Bhikshatana, or Ardhanarishvara, or Lingadva, and Gangadhara, and so on. This is one circle of the conventional deities which are distributed according to the Agamic texts. But in addition, we have another circles of deities which are called Panchabrahman. Panchabrahman are the first manifestation of Supreme Shiva in figurative form. And that is represented by Tat Purusha, Agora, Sadyojata, Vamadeva, and Isana. These five sculptures are not found in any other temple in South India, occupying the position mentioned in the Agamic literature. And that's extraordinary because in the worship of image, the central image, the linga, is called Rupa Arupa form, which is both form and formless shape, you know, circular, cylindrical shape. So the first manifestation is said to be the five Brahman, Pancha Brahma. They are also given human forms and distributed in the appropriate positions, niches. Then in the upper portion, you have a series of images going all around, holding a bow and arrow in the upper hand, and they are what are called the Rudras, Satarudras. Satarudras are the physical representation of the rays of the sun, rising sun, which remind on the earth in the intermediate space and also on the higher up. And so they are given a form and they are worshipped in the circles of worship of the main deity. And then we have further up the other images which are said to occupy the different Karna Kuta, Sala, Bhadra Sala, and so on, which are all architectural terms distributed around. And originally they represented the little peaks that went around the Meru, and deities like the directional deities, Indra, and Agni, Yama, Nirviti, Varuna, Kubera, Vayu, Isana. All these are all positioned in the appropriate position, and these small shrines going around as architectural details or the representation of the original habitats said to have been in the Mount Meru. So the king called this main Vimana as Meru, And there are two parts of Meru. One is the northern Meru, Uttara Meru, and or Vada Meru. And then the other one is the Dakshina Meru, the southern Meru. Then Dakshina Meru also represents the form of Nataraja in this temple, in this particular temple. We have inscriptional references to both the Uttara Meru, which is called Mahameru. That was a metal image of Siva seated on top of a peak made of bronze. Unfortunately, it has not survived, but with other deities like Ganesha, Subramanya, and Nandikeshwara, Surya, Chandra, and all these. These were all represented on the bronze image of the Mount Mahameru, which was south, facing northern direction. And Dakshina Meru represented in this temple by Nataraja, which was called Adavallan. Adavallan is Nataraja. And this image luckily has survived to this day. Though somewhere in the 19th century, beginning of the 19th century, it was found broken and lying in the temple without worship. And the queen of the last of the Maratha ruler, Shivaji II, who had the name Kamakshi Bibi Bai, she repaired it and reconsecrated it in the temple somewhere around the date is given, somewhere about the end of 19th century. And from then on, it is under worship. But this information is provided by a Marathi inscription on the base of the present Nataraja under worship in metal in the temple. So, one is Mahameru Vidanga, and the other one is called Dakshina Meru Vidanga. And as this temple follows an agama called Makutagama, according to an ancient tradition, it means that the main image of the temple was considered the dancing form of Shiva, that's Nataraja. So the linga here inside the Garbhagriha Sanctum represents that dancing form of Shiva, Nataraja, Adavallam. And it is this concept that has influenced the inner enclosure of the main temple and also the upper floor, where you have 108 forms of dance which are called Nrittakarma, detailed in Bharata's Natya Shastra, are formed, sculpture going around the sanctum. It almost looks as if it has been carved on the upper space, which is Akasa. Shiva's dance is said to take place in Akasa. And that is the reason why you have these 108 dance karanas portrayed on the first floor around the main sanctum, and it begins with the karana tala puspa putam at the entrance. And then the sequence as found in Bharata's Natya Shastra is found here in sculptural form, which is the earliest representation of Bharata's Natya Shastra in visual form in India, whole of India. Now this representation of Shiva's form coming out of its own body is described in many Sanskrit texts. Shiva creates multivarious forms out of his own body as the Supreme God, and that is like dance, supreme dance taking place in a theater. Just as a beautiful dancer comes whirling, and then with so many dance forms she creates, so also this sculptural representation gives the idea how they conceive the whole movement of cosmos as a dance, of the Supreme, and that is given the visual form, and that is described in Bharata's Natyashastra. This is a very, very important concept for understanding the meaning of the temple. The second part is, there is a dancing sculpture at the back of the sanctum in the Vimana, main Vimana, which is in Chatura Tandava. This Chatura Tandava, square form of dance, is generally called the Sandhya Tandava, the evening dance. In addition, we have many sculptures, other sculptures are presented, distributed. So the temple worship consists of five circles of worship. These are called avaranas, pancha avaranas, five circles from the main linga, and then you have the pancha brahma, then you have what is called Vidyeshwaras, knowledge personified, different forms of knowledge personified, Vidyeshwaras. And then the directional deities, each direction is deified and given a form, which are now enshrined in the enclosures in different directions, in the appropriate directions. And that itself forms a sort of fortification for the central palace. And the last circle, the fifth circle, is said to be the weapons of these directional deities. So, in five circles, they worship. And in all these five circles mentioned, the image, the dhyana sloka, and the form of worship are all prescribed in the agama. And that is how we find the sculpture distributed in Brihadisvara temple also. So the circle of deities, inner circle of deities, middle circle of deities, the extreme outer circles of deities are all in the appropriate position, showing that they conform to a particular written text that has come down to them, and they have followed it meticulously. And so these have all been codified, the form of worship has been codified. And then we have the temple opening into the four directions. Not in all temples you have the Garbhagriha opening out in the four directions. So this is called a particular type of architectural representation, which is called the Meru type of architecture, which will have directions on the main cardinal direction. That also you find it here. And then, according to the inscription there, the king, the emperor says, that I, the emperor, he doesn't call himself as I, he calls himself as we, the emperor, I have built this temple, and this is called Sri Vimana, the main tower, of stone in Tanjore, and thus providing a foundation information about this particular temple, when and how it was built. The king says that I built it of stone, katrali. Katrali means kal thali. Thali is temple. Kal thali means stone temple. So it means that from base to the finial, this temple was built of stone, which is called the Shuddha type of architecture. That is, you use only one material for constructing the whole Vimana, and in this case it was granite stone from base to the top. If you use other materials also along with stone, like wood or plaster, then it is called a mixed type, Misra type of temple. But the best form of architecture or temple, according to Shastra, is the pure Shuddha type of temple. So here, being a Chakravarti, an emperor, he has built his loftiest temple of single material, that is granite stone. So that he mentions in the inscription which is found on the base. Then, under his orders, the enclosure of this temple has been built by Krishnan Raman alias Mummudi Chola Brahma Marayan, who was the commander in chief, and he was responsible for supervising the construction of the enclosure, which is mentioned in number of pillars on the enclosure. Now, obviously, after the main vimana has reached a definite form and height, then the enclosure has been built and closed up. That facilitated easy movement of stone from outside and inside. Now, and in such temples, there is a prescription that you must leave enough space between the main structure and the enclosure wall. And the intermediate space is called the marmasthana, which is essential as a prakara, and also to leave the surrounding area of the structure strong enough. Any digging in between will loosen the earth and the strength of the surrounding area, and so it is prohibited in the text. And here we have the most appropriate space that has been allotted between the central vimana and the outer enclosure. And so even that forms part of the layout. And the prescription is you are not allowed to build any structure between these two places and leave the enclosure free. It is both for architectural reasons and also for ritual reasons required, and that what has been done in this great temple. So you have the main vimana, you have the enclosure space, and then the enclosure. And even outside, there are some forces which are deified and worshipped during festive occasions. So even outside the enclosure, certain amount of space has to be left out. There are two mandapa integrated into one, and we now call it the Mahamandapa. But in fact, there are two, one very close to the sanctum and the other one in the front. And so these two also were in stories. You see, they had two stories as the vimana. And the top story has crumbled at some point of time, and we have now only the lower part. And even in the lower part, we have a number of niches containing images. So in the front part, we have what we call the Ashtavasus, eight Vasus, images of Vasus are there. In addition to the two Dwarapalas, which are guarding the entrance. Then, the rear one probably was used for Snapana Mandapa, where Abhishekas used to be performed. And the front one, probably, it's not very clear, but it is in all probability, was open on all the three sides, both the sides and also the front. So, but the front one has been rebuilt. The rear part of it, closer to the sanctum, is as it was when it was built, that's the original part. In between this sanctum and this Mahamandapa, we have the entrance mandapa, which is also called Nishkramana Mandapa in text. So you have side steps in all these great temples and Chola temples. You don't enter the temple straight from the front, but the steps are provided, the sides, and both on the southern and northern sides. And they are guarded by a lovely Dwarapala. And then the Mandapa has one on the southern side, Mahalakshmi, and the other one on the northern side, you have Saraswati. Generally, the front Mandapa is considered the goddess, and the Vimana, main Vimana, is called the Purusha. And so images of goddesses are prominently there in the front mandapa. And so we have these mandapas now housing Lakshmi and Saraswati, Mahalakshmi and Mahasaraswati in the rear part of the rear mandapa. And you have where you have the steps leading out to the central sanctum. Now as you enter from the southern side to your left on the main vimana, you have the image of Surya, and on the northern side, by the side of the step outside, you have the image of Chandra. Now that is, the main sanctum is flanked by Surya and Chandra, and inside is the Mahalinga, Mahadeva, who is of the form of fire. So you have three fires represented, Surya and Chandra, which are called the celestial fires, and the main image is the terrestrial fire, Agni. So it is through these three great fires that the Supreme God is visualized as looking into the universe. So as you enter, his benign sight falls on the devotee. And so you have the sun, moon with Surya, the terrestrial fire Agni in the center. That is the linga, main linga. He is Rudra, Rudrabha. Then when we go out and come and in the form of a pradakshina, we have number of small shrines provided in the prakara enclosure. And the northeastern side, you have the sculpture of Isana, who is the presiding deity, who holds the veena, and Isana Sarva Vidyanam, he is the presiding deity of all knowledge. Then right in front, by the side of the, what you call the entrance, you have Indra, and southeastern direction is Agni. Agni is still there in position. Then and the south, exactly in the south, southern part, you have Yama, which is not there now, but the shrine is there. And then in the south western side, Nirriti, western southwestern corner, you have the Digdevata, Nirriti. And in the western side, middle, you have Varma. And northwestern side, you have Vayu. Vayu is there, Varma is there. And then in the northern direction, you have what is called Kubera or Soma. Now these are the Digdevatas which were there, and the shrines were also consecrated. Just as the main sanctum was consecrated by the Rajaguru, so also these Digdevatas shrine were also consecrated with the stupi by the Rajaguru. An inscription refers to the consecration who provided stupis on all these corner shrines. And then there are a number of empty shrines now which house the bronzes. In the southern side there were originally Saptamata and an image of Kali of stone. But of these Saptamatas we have only two sculptures now remaining. One is the Varahi, which is unfortunately lying broken and now housed and being worshipped. This Varahi. And then there was the image of Kaumari of the same side, and that was also part of the Saptamata on the southern side. So you have a rectangular shrine which housed these seven images of goddesses, Saptamata, which also included a Kali image. Then on either side of the Vimana, now you have two late temples. One is the Subramanya temple on the northern side, and Ganesha temple on the southern side. Ganesha and Subramanya are the two sons of Siva, and they always are housed as a part of the family of Siva. So one on the south and one on the north. They are the sons of Siva and Parvati, who take their position, and the argument literature gave them that position. And in the circles of worship, they also receive regular worship. That Subramanian temple had been built sometime in the 17th century during the Nayak period. But it is one of the finest Nayak structures within the temple, particularly of the Tanjore Nayak in that region. And the articulation of the base and wall and the distribution of sculptures is remarkable. Wonderful sculptures are there, wonderful mouldings are there. And on the superstructure, you have various aspects of Subramanya's sports carved in miniature. They go around. And then, of course, Ganesha was there. There was what is called the Parivara Alayat Pullayar in inscription. But it has been rebuilt by Sarfoji later, whose inscriptions are found there. And then the present Amman Shrine was a Pandya structure, which was contributed by a Pandya king around 1400. And it was originally in the Prakara, at the back of the present Amman Shrine, where there is an inscription. That shrine, Prakara Shrine, housed the original Amman image, but later on around 400, Ulahudaya Nayaki, what we call now Brahman Nayaki, her temple was built in front of it. Then in the Nayak period, it was enlarged with two additional mandapas in front. So that Amman Shrine is also a royal consecration. Now, Subramanya temple, probably also a Nayak royal consecration. And then you have the Nataraja Mandapa now, where the original bronze image of Adavallara Nataraja is there, house receiving worship. But originally it was also in the enclosure, at the back, exactly at the back. And we have a pillar in the flanking that shrine, sub-shrine, which says there was the image of Patanjali. And Nataraja shrines are always flanked by Patanjali and Vyagrapada, and this Patanjali is made of bronze and it was housed there and was under worship. So obviously in the Maratha period, a separate shrine was erected for Nataraja in front of it, which is the present Mandapa, which probably had a superstructure like a tower, small tower, which has collapsed and it looks like a flat Mandapa. Now then, you have the true...
Patanjali bronze is still there?
No. No. Then you have these two entrances. The inner one and the outer one. The inner one is called Rajarajan Thiruvasal and the outer one is called Keralanthan Thiruvasal. That is the taller one. Now the Keralanthan Thiruvasal is very interesting from architectural point of view, because as you go up, it is in stories, number of stories, as you go up, only up to the ceiling it is built of stone, hot granite, and the superstructure is built of brick and mortar. This is something that is very, very important for the history of Chola architecture. That is, during the Chola period, they had the ability and knowledge to design multi-storied building which could be built of brick. And here we have the original Chola brick architecture which runs into five stories. And up to the third story there is a step made of granite, and above that provision was made for wooden ladders to go up. And see, so if you go inside and see, that gives you an idea how in the Chola times multi-storied buildings were built, particularly the palaces were built and used. They are very well laid out, very well articulated, well ventilated, and you have excellent lighting conditions inside. But later somehow or other they have lost that technique. They don't do the same type of architectural design. So, in addition, in the inner wall, inner Gopura, you have two extraordinary Dwarapalas. outstanding dwarapalas, flanking the main entrance. And on the base, you have narrative sculptures. There are different types of sculptures that you see in this temple. One, ritual required for worship purposes. And huge classical sculptures, which are also artistic productions and also were meant for worship, daily worship and annual worship. Some of them are pure narrative sculpture, artistic expressions of telling some stories from the Siva Purana or other texts. Now you have in the inner Gopura, at the lower level, Adhishthana, you have narrative sculptures showing Shiva's marriage or Kiratarjuna fight, Kannappan stories and so on, which are lovely sculptures giving you the story in sculptural form, rather smaller size and not of the big size. So these are the narrative sculptures that you have. You have also some sculptures inside on the kapota, that is the ceiling slabs. Then this is one aspect that you see, that when you go inside the temple and stand in one corner of the prakara, you see the superstructure of this great temple, perfectly planned and beautifully going up like an absolute pyramid. And at the top you have what we call the neck or griva, and then and you have the shikara topped by the stupa. This gives an expression and it gives a feeling that you go and stand beneath it and look up. It makes you feel that you are also going toward the, you know, akash or vinna or heaven, you know, it takes you there. And if there is cloud, you must have a feeling that you are flying with the vimana. Now, this is an essential part of the architectural design, because when they do the puja, you know, they bring down the supreme power which has no direction, no color, no boundaries. But this is made to come into existence by the tip of the stupa on top of the vimana, which acts as a dot. Once you put a dot in a space with no directions, then you bring into operation this directions. 360 degrees are brought into existence on top, which we call the bindu, the dot on top of the stupa. Then gradually you bring it down by undulating lines of architectural form, which is called chandas, urdhva chandas. Like a poetry, you bring down the supreme power from the vast space, put the dot on top of the stupa, bring it down to the ground, and that's how the supreme comes down to the earth to bestow his blessings on the devotees and on the Yajamana who built it. And after the puja is over, you know, in the process of meditative dhyana, you dissolve this process of coming down and reverse the procedure, so that state by state you dissolve this whole structure before you and take it up on top of it, then dissolve it in the super space. And so the whole structure you see in front in meditation doesn't exist. It goes out of existence. So it is something of a philosophical concept that is suggested by the architectural movement line. And also they conceived, the ancient conceived it as a beautiful poetry. When you look at it, you are experiencing a lovely poetry. So it is kavya, it is a new creation, ever fresh, ever beautiful, ever appealing to the eye, and that is what it says. If the measurements are not accurate, if the measurements are not proportionate, this feeling of lovely symmetry, rhythm will be lost. So the text emphasizes that you must maintain proportion of construction. And this is taken from the main linga inside the sanctum. The upper part of the linga is the basic unit of the entire temple, of the inner sanctum, the entrance, the images, the space, the enclosure, and every limb of the central tower, the central mandapa, the enclosure, everything is proportionate to the inner linga, which in turn was designed from the middle finger of the Yajamana, that is Rajaraja the Great. So this temple is proportionate to the basic unit of measurement drawn from the middle finger of its builder Rajaraja. And so you see that everywhere you turn, you see there is an absolute proportion, absolute balance, absolute rhythm, that you unconsciously feel and experience. That is the greatness of this great temple. And then, it is not only great in architecture, it's not only great in what you call the philosophy behind it, it's not only great in the rituals that were conducted, but the clarity with which the administration was organized by the king for worship, daily worship, for periodical festivals, for annual festivals. He had made provision of material and men to carry out this in a most beautiful way. And we have the texts which say when you have a maximum number of men to do all these works, we'll call this temple Uttamottama, the best among the best. So the organization and administration of this temple, as recorded meticulously in the inscriptions of its builder Rajaraja, shows that he was a man of great thinking, great clarity, and great administrative power. He has divided it into one, provisions for pujas, provisions for festivals, provisions for the great festival that used to be conducted once in a year, annual festival, and then for the surrounding secondary deities, Parivara Devatas, and then for maintenance, day-to-day maintenance of cleaning and looking after the structural requirements and so on. And then, it was not mere ritual. Ritual is not confined only to offering of flowers and water and liquids and so on, but it also consists of music and dance. It is an essential part of the daily worship. And it is called Nritta Gita Vadya. Gita Vadyam Chaturdasam Nrittam Panchadasam Chaiva. 15th anga of the worship is Nritta. And in Nritta, that is dance, which was offered daily, both in the morning, midday and evening worship, with large number of people, for which he endowed 400 dancing girls. He provided them with houses around the temple. And he has mentioned house number one, house number two, house number three and so on. And to whom this was allotted, the name of the girl to whom it was allotted, and from where this girl came, and in some instances, what is her accomplishment or specialization in the field of dance. One may be an excellent dancer, nritta, another may be a dancer of Abhinaya, and so on. So every aspect is meticulously documented, and they were given landed property, and they were given annual bonus in gold as the king's gift annually. These are all recorded. So when we see that he gifted 400 dancing girls and more than 240 musical instrumental players, he has mentioned each and everybody's name and how much he was getting annually. And he emphasizes, whether they are dancer or musician, they must be duly qualified. And for those who were qualified, he gave a security that their descendants would be given the opportunity to do the same service in the temple. In addition to dancers and this large number of these musicians, instrumental musicians, he appointed 50 musicians to sing Tamil songs called Tevara, also Tirupadiga, which is the largest so far found. So the poems of the Siva saints who lived between the 6th and 10th century, which are sung in every temple, he gave a great boost to them by appointing them. Those who knew the ancient traditional method of singing Tamil songs, which is called the pan system. And also he appointed what you call superintendent for every department to look after the functioning of the workers, like watch and ward. There were a large area, villages, large number of villages that were gifted for supplying paddy and other requirements for the pujas. For all these, every department had ordinary workers, the middle level workers, and very great care and supervision entrusted to commanders, commander in chiefs. So the organization of administration is unparalleled in the history of India. It is simply unparalleled. And the minute detail in which he described every aspect, for example, when he gives a bronze image, he describes the measurement of the bronze image from head to foot, and then how many hands it had, and what was the form, what was the measurement, and what was the weight of the image, how much money was spent on making this image, and who was responsible for the maintenance of this image within the temple premises, because every image had someone who was attached to it, who has to look after it, so regular puja and safety. So such details, not only for the bronzes, but each bronze was given large number of golden and precious ornaments. And in each ornament he speaks about the details of precious gems, 10 or 100 or thousands of pearls, coral, ruby, emerald. Each one is counted, not a single stone was left out. And the total weight of golden metal that has been gifted in the form of vessels, in the form of jewels, in the form of other material is unparalleled. And even a small spoon which he gifted to the temple is brought under the register, entered and given name and its weight and its cost.
What could be the reason of this inscription? Why, when no others have done it, you know, what made him
do it? It is the responsibility felt by the king to see that everything is accounted, everything is well administered, and everything is supervised. But that much of clarity and involvement in the preservation, not only during his lifetime but also after his lifetime, to preserve and fix up the responsibility on someone to look after it, is the main reason why he has left so much of inscription. Then You see, the last of it I would like to mention, that he never felt that it was his only creation. He involved all the people and has written down their name. Even a servant maid who was a cook in his kitchen, her name is given. And he gives half of the grant and he makes her give the other half. And both the names of the Chakravarti, the emperor, and the name of the cook is written in one document. Like that, he has involved everyone in the administration and gift and made them feel that it is their temple. And in this method, he has involved the entire territory which was under his control, from northern part of Tamil Nadu to Kanyakumari, and even a part of northern part of Sri Lanka. He has beautified the whole temple with paintings. And these paintings, original paintings executed under his orders, are found in the inner enclosure around the main sanctum. And they are on the both sides of the walls. And they depict both the classical legends, like Dakshinamurti, Tripurantaka, Kalyanasundara, etc., which are all like narrative paintings of exceptional merits. He has also given equal emphasis to the local legends, regional legends, like the life of Saint Sundaramurti, and the king himself visiting Chidambaram temple. These are all painted with lovely lines, subdued colors, with the emphasis on bhava, the inner feeling of each and every character that is depicted. Some of the paintings depicting the dancers, dancing girls, performing outstanding poses, they are real marvels in the Brihadisvara temple. And that shows the level to which the art of dance rose under his control, under his command. And in the field of painting, in the field of music, in the field of dance, in the field of administration, in the field of planning, in the field of articulating the whole idea into visual form and architecture, and then the care and concern to preserve it for the future in good form, that makes this temple the unique temple in the history of India. Gangaikonda Choladapuram temple has a few important points that deserve our attention. That was part of a great capital that was established by Rajendra Chola, the son and successor, to commemorate his outstanding victory over Gangetic plains. He sent his army right all along the coast to go up to modern Bangladesh, where they won signal victory and brought Ganges water to this place, and establishing the capital, naming it as Gangaikonda Choladapuram. He dug a huge tank, almost like a lake, which was called Gangaikonda Choladapuram, the great tank. Then that palace, royal palace, was built inside with two concentric fortifications. Unfortunately, these were all destroyed during the later period. But as a part of that layout, original layout of the city, this great temple called Gangaikonda Choladapuram was built on the northeastern side of the palace portion. That is, he's on the dictate. And Rajendra was with his father toward the end of his life, Rajaraja. And so he had the benefit of those workers who were working there in the great temple to come and design and build this temple. But yet he had an own individuality. He wanted to express his own idea. And in this he had a great acharya who came from Gaudadesa and advised him. And so though he is a temple built within 20 years of the great temple of Tanjore, its form is different. It has the main tower at the bottom square and in the middle octagon and on the top it is circular, simulating the form of the great linga, which is generally square at the bottom, octagonal in the middle and circular at the top. And then even the enclosure layout is different. It's not absolute rectangle, but a little shorter. Also the height of the main tower is slightly shorter than the great temple of Tanjore. But the sculptural quality, the beauty of the sculptures, in some cases surpass the beauty of the sculptures in Tanjore temple, Rajarajeshwara temple. Almost every major sculpture in Gangaikonda Cholapuram are a class by themselves. You see the dancing Nritya Ganapati, Ardhanarishwara, Harihara, and Nataraja. Nataraja in stone. There is a beautiful poem in Tamil called Kunitta Puruvamum Kovvai Chevvaya Kuvin Sirippum Panitta Tadayam பவழம்போல் மேனியில் பால் வெண்ணீரும் இனித்தமுடைய எடுத்த பொற்பாதமும் காணப்பெற்றால் மனித பிறவியும் வேண்டுவதே இம்மாநிலத்தே. இஸ் எ வண்டர்ஃபுல் பயம் பை செயின்ட் அப்பர். அண்ட் குனித்த புருவமும் யுவர் ஐப்ரோஸ் டான்சிங், லார்ஜ் ஐப்ரோஸ் டான்சிங், கொவ்வை செவ்வாய் குமின் சிரிப்பும், தட் என்சாண்டிங் ஸ்மைல் ஆன் த லிப்ஸ் தட் ஹேவ் பீன் கேப்சர்ட், தட் பியூட்டி ஆஃப் தட் பொயம் ஹேவ் பீன் கேப்சர்ட் இன் தி ஸ்கல்ச்சர். அண்ட் ஒன்ஸ் யூ ஆர் இன் ஃப்ரண்ட் ஆஃப் தட் ஸ்டோன் ஸ்கல்ச்சர் ஆஃப் நட்ராஜா, யூ வில் ஃபீல் தட், யூ வில் எக்ஸ்பீரியன்ஸ் தட் இம்மார்டல் டான்ஸ் அண்ட் இம்மார்டல் ஸ்மைல். And beneath the lifted leg of this Nataraja is Karikalamaya with cymbals in her hand, who was playing. And then at the back you have other lovely sculptures like Subramanya, Chakradhan, Mutilingodvaya, etc. And on the northern side, by the side of the steps, you have Chandeya Anagraha Murti, which has captured the attention of the whole artistic world by its beauty. So the Saraswati image opposite here. These two are the most outstanding contribution of Rajendra.
Saraswati and Shiva and Parvati, no?
Opposite, on the northern side. And then this temple houses some extraordinary bronzes that were consecrated by the King Rajendra. One is Subramanya, great beauty in bronze, which is still under worship, Tomaskanda, and so on. So, Gangaikonda Cholapuram shows the extension of the achievement of what has been done in Tanjore and individuality of its own beauty in the form of sculpture. Now when we come to Dharasuram, it was originally Raja Raja Ishwaram, and in colloquial form it was called Rara Ishwaram, and then Dharasuram, it became Dharasuram. It is of a slightly different philosophy.
Why this called Airavateshwara?
Airavateshwara is quite late, colloquial name. It has nothing to do with that. It was actually Raja Rajeshwara. There are documents there, inscriptions. And so that was the secondary capital of the Cholas. And so Raja Raja, the second who built the temple, he had a capital called Rajarajapuram. And he also had an Acharya who came from Gaudadesa. So it was influenced by the Sakta tradition, and there is an emphasis on the worship of Bhairavathas, Veerabhadra, and there is a lovely Tamil poem called Takkayaga Parani, which was a dance drama composed by a court poet of the builder Rajaraja II. Obviously, it was all enacted in the temple during his lifetime, which describes the temple, building of the temple. So, but it shows the influence of both Bengal tradition and also the Hoysala tradition from the Karnataka in its sculptural form, particularly on the pillars.